winning. Today's episode is only about winning. If what you want is not winning, if truly in your heart of hearts you want to lose, then please, I mean this, turn this episode off and seek professional help. I've had to do that. But if you want to win, there are three things that you always must know in your effort to win. What winning does look like to you, what winning should look like to you, and what winning can look like.
But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done.
And it's time for another unbuckled bumpy ride with your guide, the stark raving LEAN-atic himself. I'm Jim. Let's jump right in again. Welcome to my podcast based on my brand new book, available on Amazon, Live Life Lean, L-E-A-N. It's a year-long guide to gratitude and our daily grind. The book that combines some timeless wisdom from a whole lot of the world's wiser people with the reflections, reactions, and wisecracks of the guide's author, me. And it guides you, the reader, through the simplest system for a happy, healthy, authentic, and genuinely grateful everyday experience. I urge you to get the book. Of course I do. I wrote it. It's either at Amazon or at my website, amperage.com, A-M-M-P-U-R-A-G-E. But even without it, let's make next week better than last, our next year better than the past, and get started now with today's episode of So, question. Why don't you win more often? Seriously. I'm not going all Judgey-Judgemeister on you. I'm not criticizing your floor routine or your pommel-horse dismount. It's not for me or for anyone else to say you don't win enough, but it is a valid question. Why don't you win more often? I mean, man in the mirror time here. Do you see you as born to win or doomed to lose? Honestly. All-time great football coach and pretty amazing, motivating philosopher kind of guy, Lou Holtz. He knows that we wrestle with this. Lou Holtz once said, "You were not born a winner, and you were not born a loser. You are what you make yourself to be." Yeah. Thank God for coaches, right? I mean, they know a lot about winning and about losing and about why we do or don't win more often. You remember Vince Lombardi, the man that the NFL trophy is named after? I would have said the Super Bowl trophy was named after him, but they probably would have just royally dinged me for like royalties for saying Super Bowl. Did I do that again? Okay, so Coach Vinny, he's famous for saying, "Winning isn't everything. It's the only thing." But Vince Lombardi also said, quote, "The real glory is being knocked to your knees and then coming back. That's real glory. That's the essence of it," he said. Kind of like, I don't know, it's not how hard you can hit, it's how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, where have we heard that before? Yeah, I know, I can be so sly. But it's not just football coaches who are experts on the why we don't win more category. Remember, it's really, well, really it's the players who do the real winning and losing. You know, the flying or the flailing and dying out on the field. Perhaps none is more familiar with that two-sided coin than Buffalo Bills all-time great quarterback, Jim Kelly. Well, you youngins, look him up. When it comes down to Jim Kelly, he was a four-time in a row Super Bowl starting quarterback. No one had ever done that before him. And also, Jim Kelly was a four-time-in-a-row losing quarterback. Ouch, chicka, ow, wow, that smarts. And when he was asked if he could rewrite history, would he rather go to four Super Bowls and lose every single one of them, or go to just one and win it? Well, Jim Kelly has a lot of experience and he knows what makes him feel like a winner. I think four, Kelly said, because there's a lot of guys that have won one Super Bowl. They had the right ingredient. That day was their day. But to be able to quarterback a team four times and be the leader of that team four times just goes to show what we had inside our hearts. It showed a toughness, the resiliency, and how we never, ever gave up. Maybe, after all, Jim Kelly's biggest win was that he's learned to live with his losses. So we can't ask Jim Kelly, now long since retired, why he doesn't win more. But now, that means we're just back to you and me, huh? So why don't you win more often? Could it be because you don't really know if you even want to? Huh? Well, let's drill down here. Let's cross that finish line on our winning ways, or our ways of competing that may not be so winning, or whatever. But first, we gotta line up just like everyone else at the starting line. Ready? On your mark, get set! Go ahead now and chase down the answer to that question, why don't you win more often? Well, to know that answer, you got to ask a better question, or two, or three. What kind of better questions? Well, to start, let's go back to our beginning. What does winning even look like to you? And what should, honestly, winning look like to you? And finally, what can winning look like? See, you get the answers to these, and you're ahead of the game. At least ahead of the game on answering, why don't you win more often? Three things that we should consider about that question. When asked, why don't you win more often? One, when you hear that, does it feel like, I don't know what you're talking about. I win as much as I want, or as much as I should, or as much as other folks, you know. Or two, does it feel like, man, that really bugs me. Why are you asking me that? What do you think? Like, I don't want to win more? What do you know that I don't? Or three, does it just feel more like, I don't know, I never really thought much about it. Hey, subject change, did you hear what they said on TV about that thing that might happen? And you just move on. Okay, odds are you, me, we all probably fit into one of those categories somewhere, and there may be even all of them now and then, but all that really matters for us is what winning matters to us. I mean, doesn't everybody love to win? Winning is wonderful. Just ask your brain. It goes all chemistry crazy when you feel like you've won something through work or by luck. Every brain biologically loves a win. Winning increases your testosterone, which in turn increases dopamine. And then that dopamine hits your brain. That makes you feel better. And not just feel better. It seems even live longer. Did you know that Nobel Prize winners outlive the also-ran Nobel nominees? Who are also brilliant, remember, but they get outlived. They outlive them by 2 years. Baseball players who actually make it into the Hall of Fame, apparently they get to go extra innings too, and they receive a couple of extra years on top of players who are turned down. And don't even get me started on Glamourville, USA, because in Hollywood, it's really winner takes all. Academy Award winners live, on average, 4 years longer than other actors. Who says fame is fleeting? So you think winning is enough to make you happy and smile, right? Well, not always. And this is where what winning means to you needs to be clarified. See, it's not so clear when it comes to medal sports, you know, like the Olympics. Experts say that you're going to see a common pattern of expression on the medal podiums. The gold medalist, very happy. The bronze medalist is usually pretty happy. But the silver medalist often has this sort of blank expression on their face, sort of staring out at the distance. I mean, there's no shame in silver, unless you can't stop fixating on gold. So, that not winning gold, beating the bronze, winning silver, could it really feel like you're a loser? The bronze medalists are happily just being there having thoughts that comparing themselves to everybody else that didn't get up there. So they think, wow, you know, if I'd done a little worse, I wouldn't be one of the guys up here. I'd be one of those many people that's not here on the medal stand. I made it. I'm a medalist. Like, I want something valuable, even if it's not in top spot. But the silver medalists, though, they have themselves comparing to that gold medalist. Kind of like Agent Maxwell GetSmart. Man, missed it by that much. You won the silver. I asked you not to tell me that. So when you think about answering that question from before, why don't you win more? Are you the type? Do you analyze your answer and feel like you're usually gold medal level? Or are you boasting about your bronze? And compared to all the other also-rans, that you're glad you're at least one step above and you're getting some recognition? Or are you on that stage showing the silver, but you are the also-ran, middleman, always the bridesmaid, not the bride, wondering what has got to happen for you to win, what you either feel you deserve or believe you have the potential for? See, why don't you win more could be everything from why don't we try hard enough to are we even trying at all? Playing it safe and too small? See, I've been guilty of that in the past. Have you? It could be that we don't win more because we don't acknowledge small daily victories on our way to big world championships. I mean, Michael Jordan didn't start out as Michael Jordan. Okay, well, it was his name. But you know what I mean here? It's that we don't see those lessons and steps as wins, maybe because we're perfectionists or procrastinationists or, well, okay, I made that word up. But you know what I mean. I don't know all the reasons. But you'd at least think there's one thing we all would agree on, and that's that winning is the best, right? Right? I don't know if that's so. You should see what I just watched on video. Just watched a video. Great public speaker named John Colby, J-O-N Colby. Look him up. And he asked his large audience this. This is for my competitors out there. Who loves winning? And he looked out over this big audience and said, wow, really? Because there's not a lot of hands going up. Really? Okay then, let me ask. Who hates winning? See, he, John Colby, is a terrific speaker, but it was an awkward moment between him and the crowd. He even joked and said, I don't know if you're aware, but I can see you. But I don't believe it was all really about whether or not they, the audience, could be seen by John so much as how they were seen by the others around them and how they saw themselves. See, the subject of winning can be so sensitive to us, sensitive in both motivating and defeating ways. If we say winning is important, that we like winning, does that make us come across as someone who likes it when others lose? When we beat and defeat others, does that make us out to seem selfish? And if we say we like winning, well then, buddy, or baby, why don't we do it all the time, or at least more often? There's that question again. It's a conceptual conflict that we have a hard time wrestling with if we're operating from the orientation that if we win, does that mean someone else needs to lose? Be defeated? Crash and burn in a big old heaping pile of failure? Or worse. Now, if that is how we see it, and if that's how we operate, and if so, is that how we're holding ourselves back? I mean, let's take John Colby's question about winning and drill down into it quickly by doing one thing and ask it this way. Who of you likes the idea of winning $1 million? Do you think more hands would have gone up? Well, what if there were only one single solitary $1 million prize to be had? Only one. Does that mean if you won it, that everyone else in the room, in your town, in the freaking country who didn't win, when you did win, does that make them a crash and burn loser? Now, on top of that possibility, what if I was giving away and offering a $1 million prize, again, just one, but I only had $900,000 to give, and I was going to have to take out a loan for the extra $100K in order to make good on my gift, my prize, my offer? Now, am I the crash and burn loser at your winning ways expense? Is that how it feels? I don't see a lot of hands going up. Oh yeah, podcast. But in either of these scenarios, did you cheat to get that $1 million? Did you lie or swindle or break rules and laws? Did you do anything on purpose that was unworthy of winning? No? Well, then did you deserve to win? Honestly, what did you do to deserve to win? It was just plain old luck. Maybe nothing. And maybe that's what winning is okay being to some folks. Nothing too important. I don't know. But if we operate from an orientation that our winning means either we have to be worthy or make someone else unworthy, maybe our winning that way in itself isn't worth the health that it costs us to get that wealth. The stress and distress may be too much unrest. What a freaking mess we can make it. Winning should just be when we feel blessed. So here's the key thing about winning and losing. What matters is what makes you a winner, not what someone else thinks makes you a loser. I'm going to say that again. The key thing about winning and losing, what matters is what makes you a winner, not what someone else thinks makes you a loser. If your outcomes leave you feeling like you're a loser, then ASAP, always ask the what's, the why's, and the how's. Answer those three now, and you're going to change your tomorrow like wow. Those what's, those why's, and those how's. I'm kind of starting to sound like Dr. Seuss again. All right, the what went wrong, and the what could have gone differently for a winning outcome. Your definition of a winning outcome. Ask and seek and don't knock the answer that you come up with. The why it happened and the why you allowed it and the why you're going to do different next time and the why it even matters in the first place. And then the hows. Now the hows. Now's when to face the hows because you face the what's and the why's, and now it's time to give the how to have a winning outcome a try. Because before we face our what's and our why's, the how we achieve what we like to call a win can just leave our brains crispy fried. Asking how we're going to be different before we figure out what that means and why we're motivated in the first place? That winning outcome. The one that will help you get up and face tomorrow and get back up and try again and again. So one morning soon, you wake up on that morning, that one special morning, feeling like that winner. Not the one that you were born to be, but that you chose to be more often. And now more words of wisdom to wow your socks off. This time from the all-new Get Lean, A Woman's Daily Guide to Gratitude. Today, from entry number 50, the expert said, when you feel you're at the end of your rope, tie a knot and hold on. That was from Theodore Roosevelt. And the guide's point of view on this? Everyone needs a chance and a place to rest before climbing back out of the pit. So what do you think about this? Using the Get Lean and Live Life Lean system, what have you learned recently that's new? What have you earned that wasn't just handed to you? Where are you adding to the world? And you know it's not just about you. Now be grateful for all of that. Reflect on it. Most importantly, please respect it. But before you navigate somewhere next, please like, subscribe, and share to show you care. Thank you for listening. I hope you're enjoying your copy of the Live Life Lean, L-E-A-N guide. Enjoying it almost as much as I did creating it. And if you don't have a copy yet, go on over to amperage.com or Amazon and get started today experiencing the amazing power of knowing every day is literally yours to be grateful about. And you need never feel unfulfilled again. I'm Jim Hall. And until next time, good health, God bless. And now, go get a little dirty learning something new. Earning what's not given to you. Adding to this crazy world that we share. And navigating your way to something new and next.